I started the recording.
So, you're not going to be able to edit out all the profanity?
I know. I don't. I don't edit. I haven't been editing out the profanity, Dimitri. Was I supposed to? I didn't.
I thought you were. I thought you were embarrassed by me sometimes.
Nah, I've given up. You do it so often, it's like it's too much work. It's like I'm just going to have to live with it. So I just let it happen. Everybody who's watching on Facebook and YouTube, now the real part of the show has begun, not the fake part that Bodhi started when he originally started the live stream. We're here.
I didn't share it.
Well, you could have. I'm just... Dang it.
We got to get those people hooked in 30 seconds, guy.
Well, you know, you don't want to begin a show by telling people what's on the show.
True.
So you want to give them an anecdote. Does anybody have like a cool anecdote that people can relate to that lets them know that you love them and you care about them and you're here to serve them and make their lives better?
Oh, I do.
Oh, go ahead.
Yeah, today I reached into one of the drawers in my kitchen and there was a... one of those scent things that your wife plugs into the wall to make the house smell real good.
My wife doesn't do that.
And it broke open, and as I was like looking for stuff, I got the stuff on my fingers.
Cool.
And now I smell like a 65-year-old woman who's wearing cheap perfume, and I can't shake the smell. I've washed my hands 12 times.
That is hot. That is hot. Ugh,
it's actually horrible.
My hands still smell like rusty water, so...
Oh, that's right.
I take that over.
You take the rusty water over the old lady.
Yeah.
Me, I smell like. Let me think.
Rub your hands together, real hard. It'll smell like lemons.
Well, I'm trying. Dude, they do. They smell like lemons. What the heck? Yeah. What's up with that?
Our lemon.
So what is the subject that we're going to be discussing today,
Syria.
Gentlemen?
We're talking about Syria.
Serious Syria.
We're serious. Oh, man, I should have done that. Are you serious about Syria? I said Syria is hot or Iraq Redux, but serious Syria is better. Man, I feel gypped. I feel totally robbed out of that.
That's okay. I can change my title now.
So I'm going to ask, you get to change your title midstream? I can't do that with Facebook. That's terrible. So how about we start off the show with... I'm going to throw this out there. The chemical attack, real or fake?
I think it's real.
Dimitri?
I think whether it's real or if it's a false flag is irrelevant. Events are going to materialize from the last couple days, chemical attack and bombing of a hospital, that are going to materialize in a similar way as the bombing of the open market in Yugoslavia that was attributed to the Serbs, but actually came from a Muslim-held territory. The Serbs got the pounding from NATO for that.
Oh, they got some serious pounding, yes.
So whether this is a real attack by Assad or it was a real attack by an agent of the West like Turkey to create the atmosphere to have Assad removed, either scenario is irrelevant. The fact is that there are... movements now to have him removed, and that's the important part of the story for me.
Is
that concluded?
That's where I'm at, actually. I'm open to the possibility that it was fake, but when it comes down to it, whether it's fake or whether it's real, whether Assad did it, whether the quote-unquote rebels did it to make it look like Assad did it, what it comes down to is, well, for me, there is no justification for the United States of America, even within the state-von-state phase parameters, of which I'm not really in that, but There's no justification for doing what it appears that they're about ready to do. If your justification is he's doing terrible things to his citizens and we have to stop him, shouldn't we like maybe form a like let's send out a committee and determine which leaders are doing the most harm to their own citizens and let's target them first? I don't think it'll be Assad, right?
Yeah, but that's not the point of this. Removing Assad has nothing to do with him being a horrible human being.
But that's the narrative they're choosing. Why is Bodhi typing in the middle of a show?
And why is he parting his shirt? He's getting all sexy like.
You want to show your
dude? We don't need that. Come on, this is a family show. God damn it!
This is a family show, dude.
Fucking hell! I fucked up. I'm sorry.
Well, you should be. Thank you for apologizing. I appreciate that. That went well. So, no, anyway, go ahead, Dimitri.
The bottom line is, what is the real objective here of the Russians, of the United States, of the rebels, of the Syrians, of the Iran? I mean, we can go and list a very long list of players in this. And the bottom line for me is it's about Israel. It's about Israel.
Yeah, because who's the first person that started chirping about it? Netanyahu.
Yeah, but it goes beyond. It goes beyond and before.
I mean,
What really? Look, Iran has effectively taken over Iraq. Iran could march missiles right up to the border with Jordan and target Israel if it so choose to at this point. That's how much control Iran has over Iraq. Syria is, for me, a patsy. What I believe is materializing is the breakup of Syria into 2, 3, maybe 4 states. One for the Syrians, one for the Palestinians, one for the Kurds, and one for other groups that, you know, may take a piece of it. But Israel needs a buffer between itself and Iran, and the Kurds are the ideal buffer. Wow. Great commentary here.
Well, the thing with the Kurds is, and I liked how you said, you know, whether it's a provocateur from Turkey or Turkish interests, whatever. Turkey has a huge problem with the Kurds. It's actually a little obscene how far they've taken it. And the vast majority of chemical weapons that made it into Syria were delivered through Turkey.
Oh, wow. That's absolutely true. You're one of the few people who's commented on that I've heard.
Yep.
Yeah, that's absolutely true.
I had a friend in Turkey during those.
What's that?
I have friends in Turkey that they were actually there. You know the protests over the Bosphorus Bridge, not the recent ones, but the ones prior to that. It was maybe 2, 3 years ago. And basically they had chemical weapons. They had the CS gas and stuff. It was all American made. And I actually filed a report to the UN that never got anywhere. And that was actually all happening as kind of a smokescreen, right, as all of these weapons were making their way into Syria.
And there was it did make the Turkish papers that there was an apartment flat that was full of chemical weapons in eastern Turkey. And when the Russians caught word of this, and they were able to confirm that that actually did exist, they went to NATO and said, gentlemen, don't we have treaties against chemical weapons being housed in various parts of the world?
Let alone an apartment complex?
Yeah, to which the Americans and the Turks and everyone else quickly backed off of getting rid of Assad once that happened and materialized, because the Russians had a playing card. They used that as leverage. They're like, you want us to go with war with Turkey because they have weapons they're not supposed to by XYZ treaties.
And Russia's had their eye on Turkey for a very long time.
Oh, dude, that might materialize here as well, because
they want that bridge. they want the Bosphorus. They want that trade route. Yeah, it's a huge trade route. We dumped plenty of tax dollars into building it, and we taxed the Turks on it. We have multiple military bases. It's a key place for us to launch attacks. I mean,
but there's more. There's way more to all of this now. In the last few weeks, I mean, Paul and I were talking about this a couple years ago.
Yeah.
How the dynamics there are changing, and you know, the Israelis are getting closer and closer and closer to the Arabs, and the Arabs have this thorn that they need to remove. It's called the Palestinians. So if you give the Palestinians a state in a piece of Syria and say, look, you have your own country, enjoy. Mm-hmm. They can resolve a lot of issues with the Arabs. If a Kurdistan is created, they have a buffer between themselves and Iran, and now a buffer between themselves and Turkey, because Turkey has been very antagonistic towards Israel in the last 2-3 years. Mm-hmm. But the other component here, and this is a huge component, is that Israel has discovered natural gas and oil in its territorial waters. Cyprus has found not as much, but a substantial amount of natural gas and oil in its territorial waters. Mm-hmm. Egypt has found vast sums of natural gas and oil in its territorial waters. And now Greece, it's pretty clear, has found natural gas and oil in the Aegean. None of that belongs to Turkey.
Turkey based is the odd man out.
Yeah. Based on the EEC, or is it the EEZ, the Exclusive Economic Zone, of each of those countries and how the territorial waters are divvied up, Turkey gets nothing.
Right.
So there's a pipeline now that seems to be materializing from Israel to Cyprus to Greece, and now Italy is on board. And it seems like the French want to get in on it too. And I believe Dubai and Exxon are now very much into it. And that means the United States. Mm-hmm. So they have to secure Israel. Turkey is going
to
be a
huge
threat. Why
do they have to secure Israel?
Because Israel is going to be a major source of natural gas and oil to the European Union via Cyprus and Greece.
It'll be a huge trade port, basically.
Yeah, it's going to be massive.
For a lot of Europe, too, that will free them from the dependency on Russian gas and oil.
Well, and not to mention the dependency on Turkey, because the Turks want a piece of that too, and the Turks are being squirrely. And, you know, Greece has been in a historic depression for years now. And the one thing you haven't seen happen in Greece is people out in the streets with Kalashnikovs fighting for their piece of it. Even under the worst economic conditions that a country has seen since before the Great Depression, Greece is still a stable democracy. And it's still pro-West, and it's more NATO-oriented now than before. While Turkey, who's had this huge economic explosion over the last few years, is unraveling before everyone's eyes and becoming unstable and ruled by a nut job, for all intents and purposes. The guy's kind of wacky.
He's a very hard ideologue.
He's a theocrat.
Yeah.
So Israel has realigned itself away from its 50 or 60 year alliance with Turkey, and is now choosing Cyprus, a tiny little, you know, island nation, and Greece, an economic basket case, over Turkey, which leads one to believe that NATO and Europe and Israel are all very much behind all of this. So,
and there's plenty of precedents for that.
Yeah,
it's not like it's the first time it's happening.
The fact that Iran is now at the borders of Israel, or close to, with Iraq, the fact that Turkey is becoming increasingly hostile towards Israel, and the fact that there's a war raging just north of Israel, is all cause for concern about the long-term prospects and health of Israel. So the natural gas that's been found is sure going to help matters, but they have to get it to Europe to make it viable in the marketplace. You know, if it's underground, it doesn't really help you very much. So all of these dynamics are contributing to a huge realignment in that area. Huge. And it boggles the mind that people aren't saying, oh, there was a chemical weapons attack on civilians in Syria. Well, why? Not so much who did it, but why? To advance the narrative that Assad has to go, and Assad is, and Syria are going to be thrown under the bus.
And the West needs to step in.
We need a coalition, correct, dude.
We need to do something about this. We need to be there.
Yeah, but don't be surprised if Russia isn't in on this.
Oh, no. I would actually be surprised if they were.
Now, I'm interested in that because what you just outlined, you're looking at Russia that looks kind of like it's on the bad end of an Israeli natural gas market going directly from Israel to Greece. So what interest does Russia have in this?
Well, the Russians have been meeting not so secretly with the Israelis for a couple years now.
Yep.
In relation to this. And part of it has to do with whether they're going to take this pipeline up through Syria and into Turkey to Europe, or if they're going to bypass Turkey altogether. I would not be surprised if there's a gentleman's agreement that Russia pumps the fuel from the north, Israel pumps the fuel from the south.
They can control prices.
Correct.
Yeah.
And if Syria is divvied up in a manner that pleases the powers that be, then Russia gets a piece of Turkey. And the United States gets a piece of Turkey in the name of Kurdistan. So the Russians want to establish a new Armenia in northeastern Turkey, and the Israelis want to establish a new Kurdistan in southeast Turkey. So if the Israelis and the Americans are controlling Kurdistan and the Russians are controlling Armenia, they both have a piece of Anatolia that is returned to its historic peoples, first and foremost. So it's righting a historic wrong. But more importantly, those two powers are in control of the oils that are coming out of the Caucasus now, because you have oil and natural gas coming out of the Caucasus region, and not more importantly, the Caspian Sea. And Russia wants to continue to control that. The Kurds will get a piece of that. And all of this will be a buffer against Iran.
Yep. And the wild card in all of this is kind of with the Kurds and the Peshmerga and Rojava, the kind of, I guess you would call it the anarchist community rising over there, the actual only effective fighters against ISIS, which kind of goes against everyone's plans. If what you're saying was to come into effect and you have Israel over here and you have Russia over here and you have the West and the East coming together, and it kind of isolates that pocket, that anti-state, actual freedom, actual open market idea, which is part of the reason why Turkey really hates the Kurds as well. And that's why Turkey actually supports ISIS in very select instances.
I don't think their instances are all that select. They may be covert, but they're targeted. All that select.
Right.
Now, the other component is that the Kurds, I think it was this week, announced that they're going to go for a referendum to see whether or not they split off from Iraq, which is huge because the Turks are saying if you do that, you will pay a heavy price. Well, the Kurds, in retaliation to that statement, said, oh, by the way, Kirkuk is part of the new Kurdistan if we should so choose to form a new country, which has made the Turks go nuts. The fact that they're going to get all that oil, it makes the freeing of the Kurdish territories in Turkey all that more likely. They're going to have a sway with the West. They're going to be able to buy the latest and greatest in terms of munitions from the West with that cash. And the West is going to say, hey, can we put a couple of air strips and air bases and military bases in the new Kurdistan, and the Kurds are going to be like, of course, come on down. We'd love to make new friends.
Right, because
and Turkey is then screwed.
Right, because then Ankara doesn't become so critical.
Correct. Well, and they've done this to themselves. Like, if you look at the history of NATO in the 20th century, Greece and Cyprus were like not even second-rate players in NATO. Not because they don't have capabilities, but because the Turks use their geostrategic position to tell America and the rest of NATO, hey, look, you know, yeah, exactly. We want this, 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 and this. And they gave them whatever they asked for, including Northern Cyprus, because they were a far more valuable asset to NATO. But now that the Turks have gone back guano, crazy.
Technical term, back guano.
Yes,
back guano, yeah.
NATO's looking at the situation, Israel's looking at the situation, and everybody in the neighborhood's looking at the situation and say, hey, maybe we should give these Greeks a chance. They're a lot more stable. They're a democracy. Even through the worst of times, they've, you know, held it together. And in the best of times, Turkey's now starting to unravel with civil wars and coup attempts and crazy dictatorial leadership and what is going on over there. So the establishment of Kurdistan works in everybody's favor, and the Turks did it to themselves.
Yep. Except that's Kurdistan crazy. Doesn't. The problem is the Kurdistan that would form would not actually be in favor of the Kurds.
In Turkey.
In Turkey, or even on the even in Syria, yeah, even at that whole area, that they're fighting. They're between a rock and a hard place right now, and any outside influence is not a helping.
Dude, but every step forward for Kurdish independence is a step forward for Kurdish independence. It's just like
they wouldn't consider
fighting
that
against the Ottoman Empire.
They're fighting against a state. They're fighting against all states, actually.
And so were the Greeks when they were fighting against the Ottoman Empire. Anyone who supported the independence of Greece against the Ottoman Empire was looked upon by all the royal families in Europe, from Russia to England, all the way across, as a threat, and they were executed immediately. So Greek independence, the fact that that happened with every nation in Europe against them, politically against them, while citizens of Europe were for it and lent support and money and assets to the Greeks, the Greeks got the Peloponnese as the first modern Greek state. The Kurds just have to establish a state with political and diplomatic ties with other countries, and they have now a viable chance of reuniting Kurdistan, which would be part of Iran too. And wouldn't the Israelis love to kick off a revolution inside of Iran to destabilize Iran with the 10 million or so Kurds that live there?
Yeah, but that's
an interesting prospect.
But that's where I don't think the Kurds that are currently fighting would actually go along with that, because they're pretty staunch about anti-state. Even if it means independence, quote unquote, they have their independence right now. They just don't have a state; they have a nation.
What do you think? What percentage of Kurds do they represent?
Rojava?
Yeah,
it's a very small portion.
So I think maybe Dimitri's talking. You would be talking, Dimitri, about the larger Kurdish.
Northern Iraq. Northern Iraq, if it declares independence, if the Kurds in northern Iraq declare independence from Iraq, you have a viable state now that has support from Israel and the United States and lots of other players.
Sounds a lot like ISIS.
How so?
Sounds like that would be the state of ISIS. That would be the Islamic State.
How so?
Essentially.
Would they be? I don't.
Because that's what we've been supporting. That's what we've been supporting in Syria.
No, but the Kurds in northern Iraq have been autonomous for 10 or 15 years now.
Yeah.
And they've been, they're not terrorists in general. I mean, the Turks see them as terrorists.
Well, in what sense do you are you comparing saying that because when you say that, Bodhi, immediately I'm thinking that you're calling Kurds Islamo, whatever you I say Islamo.
No, I'd say the establishment of a Kurdish state would end up becoming an Islamic state quickly against the wishes of the Kurds. I think it would be like a it would be a false pretense. It would be like how.
But the Kurds, the Kurds typically. Iraq. Yeah, but the Kurds typically are anti.
Yeah, I'm a little confused at your. I don't see the evidence that suggests that the Kurds are pre-made to.
Not the Kurds themselves, but a Kurdish state, like a Kurdish state, would quickly be overrun. Would be infiltrated and overrun.
By who?
The Islamic State.
Oh, no, dude.
The Kurds with the can't proper stand the Islamic funding, State. I don't
Yeah, by the proper
funding. I understand that, but the Israel? Formation of a state in alignment with other states would make it susceptible.
Would make it a target, you're saying, and they would then be overrun.
I think so.
Yeah, but I think the Kurds in northern Iraq would welcome Israelis and Americans and Russians and Europeans to go in there and help them fight off Islamic State or any other radical.
They're already kind of asking that they back off because they're fucking things up.
Who's asking to back off and who's fucking things up?
The Peshmerga, the American weapon drops, the airstrikes and stuff, they're not helping. They're actually messing things up. They're actually aiding ISIS.
Now,
weapons are falling in the wrong hands.
Are you talking about the current, like what's going on now, or what was going on? Has it not fundamentally shifted? I don't know. Has the type of bombings and weapons drops, has that changed, or is it still just as reckless? So it hasn't really much changed.
It hasn't made much change, and just their sheer determination and fighting has really done it. They've kind of done it on their own. I don't think anyone else could take credit for helping them.
So if what you're saying is true, it sounds to me, Bodhi, like the Kurds are, wow, they're darned if they do, they're darned if they don't. They might as well just move to Somalia.
Yeah, well, I want to draw parallels to, I mean, they said the same thing about other groups that freed themselves from the Ottoman Empire, they're doomed.
See, I don't think the formation of a state is freedom.
Well, I don't think anybody's arguing for or against that point. I'm
right, but that's what I'm saying is if these things happen and the Kurds are convinced that okay, we're gonna have this state now. I don't think they're gonna buy it. I don't think they're going to trust the West. I don't think they're going to trust these other powers.
Yeah.
It's going to be like it'll be like Vietnam or even Korea, where we're creating a state. We're giving them this idea of independence so we can insert
our agenda. Yeah.
Right.
Oh, without question.
This isn't a magnanimous thing that's going on here.
That's not the point of what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, okay, yes, I agree with you wholeheartedly with that. But the chances of a Kurdistan emerging out of this to facilitate a buffer between Israel and Iran, Israel and Turkey, is quite likely.
Right.
At this point.
That's basically what I mean by I don't think it's in the interest of the Kurdish people.
Oh, no, it's not. No, nothing. Any time that a Western power comes to you and says, hey, you guys, we'll protect you, it's not in your best interest.
Yeah, well, look at, I mean, in recent history, look at Ukraine. Hey, man, these horrible dictators you got to get rid of them and replace them by neo-Nazi dictators instead of the, you know, Marxist kind of type. You gotta.
And then everyone's sitting there's like, how about neither?
Yeah. How about this is a false dichotomy. False dichotomy.
How about you fuck off?
Yeah. Yeah. Unfortunately, people listened, and you know, not that I'm a fan of the administration that predated the one that was currently elected in Ukraine, but the guy was elected. They could have held elections. They could have ousted him in a more, I don't want to say peaceful way, but in a better way, and then taken control of the country. But what they did was played right into the hands of the Russians.
Yep.
And you know what happened. But
well, what happened in Greece after World War II, right?
Oh, dude, what happened in Greece after World War II was...
Same thing that happened in Serbia.
Yeah, it was pretty horrible. The Greeks had split into two different groups that fought the Germans after the Greek military lost to the Germans eventually. The partisans and the royalists. And when the war, when the Germans lost the war, the British came in, and instead of implementing a kind of strategy to bring the partisans into the military fold like they did in France, they pretty much started rounding up the partisans in Greece for being Marxists and completely alienating them. And the way they did that was by releasing all of the Nazi sympathizers from prison and putting them in charge. So the country that fought the Nazis and hated the Nazi sympathizers was now being run by the Nazi sympathizers.
Yep.
And so thank you.
And that was where you saw a lot of the backlash out of Turkey at the time from the communists. The communists were basically the ones fighting the fascists. In Turkey, anyway, at least in the Balkans. That was that huge clash, which there's a lot of people still in Turkey today that still identify with the communists.
Right. And they still plant bombs, and they still try to undermine the state.
Yep.
But so Greece, you know, had been in a civil war after World War II, and it really never recovered from World War II or the Civil War. And I mean, not to make this a history lesson on Greece, but they got used by everybody because they weren't in a position of power. They couldn't develop their economy the way they wanted to, and they weren't allowed to. I mean, Greece has been a protectorate of Europe ever since it got its independence, and these pipelines and the economy that will be emerging in 5 or 6 years is going to be something very different than the Greece you knew.
The Greece you knew, yes.
Yeah. I think it was the foreign minister of Greece came to the United States recently, and instead of going to Washington saying, "You need to help us, these Turks are just out of control. You know, what are we going to do with these guys?" Instead of doing that, the guy came in and says, "How can we better integrate the NATO? How can we help you establish NATO as a more viable military institution?" They weren't there begging for help. They were looking how they could support, which is a complete shift in Greek foreign policy. And the fact that they've closed such close relations with Israel in the last 2 or 3 years,
yeah, and that's, reinforces this. I mean, this. Greeks and Israel don't traditionally, they don't have a great relationship, I'll just say.
They did not, because the Greeks supported the Arabs and the Palestinians. But Greece and Israel just signed a status of forces agreement. Is it status or state? I forget the terminology.
I think it's status of force.
Status of forces agreement. Israel has signed that agreement with one other country, the United States. And what essentially it does is if an Israeli warplane accidentally bombs a field and kills a farmer and a donkey, he won't be tried in Greece. He'll be taken back to Israel and he'll be tried in Israel. And if a Greek soldier in maneuvers in Israel while they're practicing accidentally shoots a farmer in the field and kills his donkey too, he won't be tried in Israel. He'll be tried in Greece. So the level of military cooperation between Greece, Cyprus, and Israel right now, Israel has not done with any other country other than the United States. There is a tectonic
Teutonic or Platonic?
No, not Platonic. Like the...
The Teutonic is the German.
No,
thing.
The plates on the Earth.
Tectonic.
Jeez Louise.
Bodhi,
a tectonic shift.
I don't know this word.
In the geostrategic alignment in the Eastern Mediterranean at the moment. And now Egypt wants to be a part of it. Dubai is a part of it. I mean, there's a huge shift. And Turkey and Iran are being left out intentionally. And with good reason. But how this comes together in Syria, goes back to my original assessment. The Israelis need to find a home for these Palestinians, and Syria is it.
And there's a lot of Arabs that want that settled because...
Correct.
I think that they're looking at Israel as a good partner, trade partner, and they want to get over the ideology stuff, but not because they're noble, because there is use. The folks in power in these states, whether it be at Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Dubai, all they had to do before was oil. And now oil is like, you know, there's a lot of players out there for oil now. You know, that whole, oil is a finite resource, it's going to dry up. And, oh, wow, there's like way more oil than we thought there was. So, well, let me finish, Dimitri, because I see you want to say something. I see you. I see you at the corner of my eye. So now they have to do more than oil. Now they have to do commerce and trade, and they have to participate in a more full way on the world market. So now they're looking, they're like, dude, we can't do it this way anymore, man. We've got to clean stuff up so that we're able to open up these trade routes and do us some serious business because we want to stay in power. And
that is
the bottom 40%
line. Of it. That's 40% of it. The other 60% is that Saudi Arabia is shitting itself over the incursions of Iran and its elements
throughout the Gulf. Yeah, you're absolutely right about that, yes.
And the Saudis see Israel as a viable partner and buffer against Iran.
Better Israel than Iran for Saudi Arabia because I always forget which one is which. When Sunni and Shia are different. Which
correct. So the Saudis are mortified at the prospect that Iran might invade because if it did, they're done in 2 days. That's the level of Saudi Arabia's military. Yeah. It doesn't exist.
Well,
they have really good.
It's the fifth. If the fifth largest. It's the in terms of money spent. It's the fifth. I think they're in the top 10 as far as money that they spend on military.
I think Bulgaria could take them out in 2 days.
Yeah. They at least have experience.
I think Canada could. No, not Canada. Not Canada.
Well,
Canada probably could.
I'm just kidding. Okay, I'm kidding. Well, I have Canadian friends. Hopefully,
Quebec,
they're watching.
And the answer to that is yes. Although I love Quebec and I love
Quebec.
Yeah, whatever.
Quebecois.
So Saudi Arabia and the Arabs are looking at Israel as, hey, little buddy, if these crazy Iranians invade, can you help out, bud? We'll help out. You have lots of resources now, like natural gas and stuff, right?
You can pay for it.
We can help out.
God bless you.
Thank you.
God bless you, Bodhi. I just said that at random.
And so the other component here is that Greece, because it transports all of their oil, has had excellent relationships with the Arab states for the greater part of the 20th century. So now it is a bridge for a lot of the Arab countries and Israel, and it's working to bring Egypt closer with Israel. It wants to bring Egypt into this partnership. They're pushing
the coalition of the willing.
Yeah, dude, it's out. It's not a secret that the Greeks are pushing to create a southeastern equivalent of NATO that will be stationed on the island of Rhodes. For those of you who don't know the significance, the historic significance in the Middle Ages of the island of Rhodes. It was at where I believe the Knights of St. John were stationed or based. And the Knights of St. John were primarily there to keep the Muslims out of Europe. The symbolism there is insane.
Would not be lost on the Turks.
Right. And they're repackaging it not to keep the Muslims out of Europe, but to keep the Turks at bay. And everyone in that part of the world, including Egypt, wants to see someone step on the neck of the Turks.
I'll just add this little thing to the mix. There are no neat alliances and partnerships. There's a lot of things that actually contradict one another. Like one of the contradictory factors is it may not be in Turkey's best interest for America to suddenly get serious about removing Assad. But Turkey absolutely wants Assad removed. So,
right.
What? Yes. And it will definitely be not in Turkey's best interest if it turns out that Russia has decided, Assad, it's time to go. And you think about it from the Trump administration perspective, and if the Russians are slick, and they've shown that they're pretty slick. They're 3D chess players, so I wouldn't be surprised if they do this. If they're slick, I wouldn't be surprised if Russia offers some sort of. Although my brother is telling me, I tried to get him on the show, by the way, total wuss, he wouldn't do it. He's telling me that he's been looking at Russian media and they've been kind of quiet. But if they were smart, they would at least put up a show that, you can't do this! You can't do this!
Because they know that the pooch has been screwed.
I actually think that, like you said, Dimitri, in a conversation before we began, that they could very well be in on it. And it could very well be, for one reason or another, they have decided, no, Assad won't listen to us. Maybe Assad isn't doing the stuff that they keep telling him to do. And they're like, you know what? And maybe Russia and the U.S. is going to work out a deal where they're going to replace Assad with someone that, you know, Russia will keep its bases right where they're at. And they'll be Russia-friendly and U.S. And they're kind of divide the spoils between them.
Did we forget the recent attack on the Russian metro?
I did not. How does that tie into this?
I think that's what's kind of. I think that kind of made Russia go, I think that's why they're a little bit more quiet.
I don't have the connection. Are they saying that Assad is? I mean, maybe what they're thinking is Assad is unstable. He's not strong enough, and as long as he doesn't crack down like we need him to do, we're gonna have this crap.
I think that attack is the U.S.'s handiwork.
Wow! So you were all upset earlier, where you were thinking how ridiculous to believe that this was a false flag, the chemical attack.
Not a false flag. A fake attack.
No, what I'm saying, but you seem to be ready to go out and theorize that the United... I nothing would surprise me, but you seem ready to go out and say, yeah, the United States... you're not saying they did, I understand that, but you're ready to entertain the thought, seriously, that the United States staged that attack and Russia got the message.
Not staged.
Well, allowed it to happen, helped to facilitate it to happen, yeah.
Correct. Yeah,
and that Russia got the message, and somehow before, maybe in back.
And maybe channels, not that Russia got the message, but that Russia's just watching. It's almost better to not speak at this point.
I think
the less information they give, the less they respond to, the more we don't know how they're taking it or what they're doing
or what they know. They're not exposing their position.
Yeah. They're
right. And that's something Russia has always been really good with. They have been really good with. That's one thing Putin is quite pro at.
Yeah.
You never really know what exactly they're thinking. Cause it took us a while to figure out what they were doing in Ukraine. And Russia didn't really speak up about our special forces in Ukraine either. they knew. We all knew we had troops on the ground in the Ukraine. It wasn't like a super secret, but Russia didn't blow it up. Russia didn't really didn't talk about it. It was just like, fine, we'll kill them there too.
Yeah. What do you think, Dmitry?
I think this is a hot stew with lots of moving pieces as it's swirling around. And what comes out of it in the end is going to be very interesting. We definitely live in a very interesting time in history. Yep. Where huge moves are being made by big players. And it's going to be very interesting to see this. I open up the newspaper every day on my phone, and every day I go, no way. Like, if that news was
that would be huge news, but now it's like maybe a second or third tier news item.
Right. But and if you put that piece in with the next piece, with the next piece, with the next piece, you're like, oh my God, there's something happening here. And it's ginormous. The world is fundamentally changing. You remember when, prior to the Soviet Union breaking up, it was the good guys in the West and the bad guys in the East. Those commie bastards with their AKs.
That was all a lie, but it was a lie that was easy to sustain. Yeah.
But that was the mythos of the day. And
it was easy to sustain.
Right. And then after that, you had Russia, for me, was Boris Yeltsin. You know, a drunk guy who couldn't, like,
Russia was hapless, right? For a while, Russia was, yeah, it was, Russia was drunken Barney for a while.
Right, but the world was stable, like, in the 90s and the early 2000s. And
the 90s was boring when it came to news. Most exciting item in the 90s was Monica Lewinsky. Correct. Monica Lewinsky happens today, and everybody would be like, meh. No big deal. It wouldn't even rate today. But it was like major news for days and weeks and months. And now it would be like the third or fourth or fifth story item.
I don't even think it'd make it that high. But now you have Israeli jets practicing sorties on European Union territory or over territory. You have just crazy stuff that you would never have imagined 20 years ago. Here we are in the Twilight Zone looking at events and like, how is this possible? What is going on behind the scenes here that is facilitating this? And you see the dynamics. It all has to do with the future viability of Israel and the future coming to the world stage of Iran, because Iran is going to be a major player.
Yeah.
And for the West, lots of little countries up against Iran, meaning, you know, geopolitically, geostrategically stacked up against Iran, is a much better dynamic than one or two large countries there. Because those one or two large countries may bail. Divide and conquer is a much better strategy. And if you chop the Middle East up into lots of little countries, you can more easily manipulate them into being on your side.
Lots of little countries that, like we're talking about with Kurdistan, that would rely heavily on the Western powers to protect them.
Right. Correct. And you know, they would have much smaller economies, smaller GDPs. They would fit within the Western political strata much better.
Buddy, could you lean up, please? You're out of the shot.
Sorry.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
So
let's be professional.
I don't know how your thing's set up.
I'm giving it to you.
Yugoslavian solution to Turkey has been in the works since the Yugoslavian solution to Yugoslavia took place. I mean, the Europeans have been looking at Turkey and saying, you know, we don't want these guys in the European Union. And they're a pain in the ass. And we're starting to see what all their neighbors see. They're arrogant asses.
They're jerky
And
faces.
yeah, and they're willing to
I'm not a
use
fan of the
force.
Turks.
Yeah. Not a, I haven't really met a Turk I didn't like as an individual. But as a state, well, maybe you've met some that you.
Bodhi has a personal relationship story that
Oh.
probably, I don't know if you want to tell it, you don't need to, but if you want to,
No,
feel free. But
I'd rather not.
yeah, he definitely has a personal story to tell about
But
that.
as a country, are you crying? Is it that sad for
Yeah,
you?
he's
Oh,
crying. He's crying.
that's a
Actually, it's been 12
dude.
it's In case she's watching.
Oh, so,
Wow. I thought it was a he, but okay. No, I'm just kidding. I know it's a she. I was
oh,
kidding.
oh, probably a lot of he's.
Oh. Oh.
Paul, we don't judge.
We
We don't
don't.
judge.
We're no judgment here, Bodhi. None whatsoever. He's gone down. No, none whatsoever.
But the country is sociopathic. The Germans at least recognize that they killed a few million people, and they say, "Hey, you know what? We recognize we did this, and we're sorry." When it comes to the Turks and what they did to the Armenians, what they did to the Assyrian Christians, what they did to the the Pontos Christians, what they did to Greeks in Western Thrace, Christians in general, you're talking 1.5 to 3 million people that they murdered and enslaved and subjugated. And they're like, "Yeah, well, it was part of war. Things happen." It's like,
It's like,
yeah,
doesn't just
no,
it's not
it
just
went a
like,
little,
oops, I accidentally, like.
yeah, it no, it went a little bit beyond that. So they're not willing to like they are not a mature culture. To be a mature, self-confident culture, you can come out and say, "Yeah, folks, I really screwed up here. I apologize. How do I make things right?" You would expect that out of an adult. I would expect my 6-year-old to say, "I didn't do it. I didn't do it. She did it. She did it," and start pointing fingers because they know they're going to get a good butt whooping. And that's what Turkey's been acting like.
You're a
And
violent man.
they
Go
have an
ahead.
additional they have an additional problem. They know that the house they live in was stolen. And they are the thieves. And they know sooner or later the proper owners are going to come a knocking and say, "It's time for you to get out."
The
So,
ghost of Ataturk.
yeah. So this is a huge problem for them because with all of these new genetic studies being done, I think the total Turkish DNA in Anatolia is something like 15 to 20%. And the rest of it, the 80%, are all the indigenous groups that existed there before the Turks showed up.
Well,
So you have.
so they have a real problem if they want to take the Aryan approach, which they actually do want to take the Aryan approach.
Oh,
They're
absolutely.
modeled after the they're literally modeled after the Nazis, literally.
Correct. So in Western Turkey or
They are
Western
Bodhi. They are
Anatolia,
Bodhi.
the predominant genetic markers are Greek. In Eastern Anatolia, the predominant genetic markers are Persiatic. The Armenians are part of the Persian group, as are the Kurds. And there are other groups, the Assyrians, that were there and were indigenous to those lands. And those groups make up 80% of the DNA in Anatolia. So it's the culture and the language that has survived through the empire. The actual Turkic peoples are a huge minority within their own country. And the elites there know that this is the case. And once people there start figuring it out, they're going to start to say, "Well, wait a minute, I'm part Armenian. Wait, I'm like 80% Armenian. What does an Armenian look like? Well, he looks like me. Well, how does an Armenian live? Well, he lives like me. What religion is an Armenian? Oh, wait a minute, I'm not that religion. Why not? Oh, what happened to the Armenians? oh, that was wrong. And now the narrative starts to fall apart.
Well, that pretty, is pretty much, Turks, pretty much Turks are just the real cultural Turkish whatever is basically kind of just Istanbul. And that's pretty much their only real European, quote unquote, ties. And that's where all their power is. Turkey is huge. And all of Eastern Turkey is much more, like you said, the Persians, basically.
Eastern in mentality and culture and norms.
Yes. And basically, vast majority of them are just poor farmers.
Correct.
Not to be insulting. I mean, that's their culture. Well, that's their way of life. There's nothing wrong with that. But it's vastly different than the way they live in Istanbul.
Correct. Well, it's Western Turkey that's more European and Western-minded. And it's funny that Erdogan comes out of that and rejects it.
Yep.
And he prefers the company of the folks from the heartland. Because they're more... what's the word we're looking for? Not religious, not pious, but he's
conservative.
Conservative.
Americans would understand it as conservative.
Right, conservative in an Islamic sense.
Yes. Correct, because there's conservatives in Turkey in the Kemalist sense too, and they're, you know, very nationalistic but secular. Versus Erdogan, who's nationalistic and super religious. Or at least that's what he pretends to be.
Oh, yeah. Well, he has chosen that the path for Turkey is an Islamist state. That the secularism needs to go away while embracing the theocratic aspect of Islam. Which, you know, I want to make it, many Muslims don't embrace the theocracy, but he's in bed with the ones that do. And he's pushing for that.
And so the West looks at him and says, do we need to treat him like we did Milosevic? Because he wasn't playing ball either. And so these conversations about a Yugoslavian solution for Turkey keep resurfacing. And they resurface not because the West has it in for the Turks. It's because the Turks have so many insecurities about their own identity that when they do achieve something, their hubris is off the charts, as is Erdogan's. And it backfires on them because he has alienated all of his allies. You know, their foreign minister, the one prior to this, the one that came in with Erdogan, had said, you know, we're going to take a Kemalist approach to our foreign affairs. We're going to not want problems with any of our neighbors. Right?
Right.
No problems with the neighbors. That was the Kemalist approach, right? At this point, Turkey has a serious problem with every single one of its neighbors. Not only that, but it now has a problem with all of Europe. It now has a problem with the United States. I mean, dear God, they arrested a Christian, American Christian pastor and charged him with terrorism. The man's been in Turkey at the head of a small congregation for 23 years. They arrested him and want to exchange him for the guy, the Turk here in Pennsylvania. What's his name? Gulan?
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. They want to do
that's a fair exchange. Trade. Right. That's a fair trade.
They want to do a prisoner exchange essentially with their NATO ally.
Good move.
What hubris to think that you.
Well, Troy fell once. It can fall again.
Correct.
For those of you who don't know, Troy was on the west coast of Anatolia, present day Turkey.
Came into like a Trojan horse.
I came into my life like a Trojan horse.
There you go.
By the way, that song, that is by...
Do you guys need to take a break and kiss or something?
No. Demetrius, I sent you that song. Come on, I sent you that.
It's like our theme song.
Okay,
yeah. Okay,
I do not endorse that last comment.
Yeah.
Sorry. I don't.
So,
especially the way you did it, Bodhi. That was
so by pissing off every single one of their neighbors, all of their neighbors are looking at them and saying, oh my God, these people are crazy. We need to work together. The Turks brought Israel, Cyprus, Greece, Egypt, Bulgaria, Italy, France, go on down the line together and are looking at Turkey as a serious problem. Before it was just the Cypriots and the Greeks that were looking at them as a serious problem. Now you have Bulgaria, who is not particularly friendly with Greece at any given day, starting to think about, hey, maybe we should also allow the Israelis to fly in Bulgaria to train, and we could train with them as well. It's like, whoa, what? An Eastern European country that's been very anti-Israel for the better part of the 20th century is now going to allow... Actually, I think it allowed it a year and a half ago for the Israelis to fly through and practice. Serbia is realigning. I mean, there is a huge move, and it's all against Erdogan in the Eastern Mediterranean, and it's not going to end well for them.
No.
It's not.
So we're past the 1 hour mark, so I think we should try to wrap this up.
Well, we got to get this conversation back to Syria.
Actually, I was going to do that.
It's about time you did something. You know what I'm saying? You need to rein it in and control your guests, man.
Yeah, man.
This guy Brody, he talks too much.
Brody, you're Brody now. I like it. Right, you're Bodhi the Brody. What do you think of that?
No.
Bodhi the Brony.
Brody. Nice hat.
I know it's a Brony hat. That's a Fump is it's one of the My Little Pony characters, and he wants to truck Fump in. So that's what that's about. And
wow,
My Little Pony character Fump. It's his favorite. He's a Brony, and I don't judge you for that though. So Syria. What good, if any, will come from Syria? Not for the powers that be. Not for the owners and managers of the coercive enterprises that are negotiating what's going on. But for you and I, for the people on the street, especially for the people in Syria, but even for us, what good will come from a war with Syria?
I think they're in for a hell of a time. Not a good one.
Who's in for a hell of a time?
Syrians.
Oh, it's...
I think they're fucked.
I think it's going to get even worse than it already is, if you can imagine that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because the enclaves that Assad has kept alive, literally kept the Christians and the minorities alive behind, they're going to be targets now. If we really do start targeting them, and if Russia's in bed with the West now and saying, you know what? We tried to talk sense into this guy, but he's off in another world. Do what you got to do. Then all of those groups are going to suffer.
Here's the thing for me that I think is telling is, well, it could be telling. If Assad was really the issue, and if Russia was playing along, if it was just about removing Assad, then why can't they just take him out? They really, with Russia's help, you don't think they could take Assad out? Just assassinate him?
It's not just Assad. He has a whole network there. He has entire towns and cities. And
well, I understand that. But if you take Assad out, it's going to sap a lot of that commitment, a lot of that. Network.
Yeah, but if they take Assad out, now there's no fall boy. There's no.
Oh, you have
no
somebody. You have somebody in the wings ready to go.
But that's not going to be so easy with all of those communities are already behind.
So you're going to
already backing
you're gonna,
Assad. They immediately know what's up.
Yeah, you're going to put your guy in there, and as soon as his feet touch the ground,
no, you're not going to put your guy in there. You're going to put somebody in there that these groups are like, okay, we can accept this guy and we can...
They've been trying. They
can't. The people who support Assad are not going to Except so, anybody. So if the I, minute they stick their feet on the ground, they're going to get a bullet in the head.
So what you're saying then is that Assad actually has a core of very powerful people who are very much loyal to Assad. That it's Assad that they're loyal to. That's the thing. And anybody Dude, else?
All the Syrians I know here in my area, and there are a lot, are pro-Assad. Very much pro-Assad. And they're all Christian Syrians and do not say something bad about Assad and his family because they've protected the Christians there for decades.
Assad would actually, he was the only Muslim leader. Well, maybe this isn't true, but he's the only, allegedly the only Muslim leader that would actually, in Christmas, celebrate Christmas with Christians.
And that is a problem for the Turks. And that's why the Turks started to target him, because they started to believe that he might have been a cryptic Christian, because he celebrated
hidden
more
Christians.
Than just Christmas.
Hidden Christians.
What's that?
Hidden Christians.
Hidden Christians.
I know, but there's a thing that we're in the Liberty community. There's this thing called hidden commies, and so this is now hidden Christians. Same thing. You see a Christian behind every bush.
And Turkey.
Yep. Hopefully the bush isn't burning. Bottle. Sorry. Too easy.
Wow. So Turkey has this problem too, because there are a fair amount of Turks that go to the West and then re-embrace Christianity. There's a large swath of people who know what their identity is, or their identities were prior to the Ottoman Empire, and they consider themselves Christians but are just going along with things. And if Turkey actually became a free country, that's the problem with Turkey really entering the European Union. It's not that it's going to flood Europe with Muslims. It's that all the Christian groups inside of Turkey are going to start to want their freedoms to practice their religions as they so choose. That is a huge problem for the Turks.
Well, I mean, Europe's already kind of flooded with Muslims.
Dude, when you look at percentages, it's nothing.
It's not huge, but the general mindset of Europeans is that there's a huge Muslim influx.
But you can think the media.
Perception is reality. Yeah.
Essentially, that's how people act.
Yeah, but that's the media getting people scared and off balance to advance agendas like they always do.
Yeah, absolutely. So the bottom line is, folks, that you're being played if you're actually buying into this whole Syria thing. You're being played, and the powers that be, they're not acting in the best interest of anyone but themselves. And there's going to be a lot of bloodshed, including possibly your sons and daughters that you're going to send over to over to Syria.
And maybe not, maybe even here.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Yeah.
I would not be surprised. Yeah. If someone was pissed off enough to attack.
You're going to tick off more people. Hey, what about all these, what Dimitri just said? What about all these, I don't know how radical they are, but what about all these folks that are already here, these Syrians that are already here? And I'm not trying to plant a fear thing, but you're going to go after Assad. In targeting Assad, you're going to have to target the people that support Assad that are probably the families of the people that are over here now. Mm-hmm. What do you think? You might just trigger someone, literally.
The Syrians that I know here are very stable and very much anchored into American culture.
It would be an isolated.
Yeah,
I'm not
very,
about,
very isolated.
Yeah.
But you will be affecting people's families.
Oh,
without question.
Yeah, yeah.
Like that's
without question. But here's the funny thing.
Let's just
say
you'll be killing people.
But here's the funny thing. We bombed Serbia. You would think there's a lot of Serbs in the United States. You would think that one of them would say, you know, screw this. I'm going to go shoot up a mall. No. No, they didn't. You know who goes and tries to shoot up a mall and a military base? The people we were bombing the Serbs for. The Kosovars. Albanians. Go on down the list. Every few years, there's one or two of them that are here that are trying to pull off a terrorist attack against America. Explain that to me.
They're pissed.
Interesting. Kenneth,
they're pissed at the people who saved them or freed them from the crazy Serbs.
I want to interject. Is this actually? I think Kenneth. Hey, Kenneth. Kenneth, yo. He asked this question, which he must have came in late. He didn't hear earlier. He said, "If Syria is broken up, do you see a possibility of a deal where a Palestinian state is set up there, removing their settlements on the Gaza Strip?" Boom.
Booyah!
Yeah. We talked about that, Dimitri. Oh, two plus years ago, Dimitri introduced this theory to me that I was like, whoa, that the whole, all of this, the whole destabilization of Syria, the whole empowering of the Islamic State, that all of it was designed to purge Syria of people so that you had land to move the Palestinians in and settle the Palestinian problem so that the Arabs could then do business with Israel without the Palestinian problem ticking off their right. I don't even want to call them citizens or what.
I mean, this may come off as like, a conspiracy. But think about it. In order to settle a dispute between Arabs and Israelis, the Arabs' argument to Europe is, look, we didn't cause World War II. Why do we have to take these Israeli refugees here, and now they have their own country here? We didn't cause the problem, but you're making us deal with the problem now.
Right.
And in fact, Palestine actually took them in, and they were actually getting along.
At the beginning, yes.
Yeah,
element was introduced, right.
So
and the it was actually working.
Right.
Then the Germans stepping up and saying, okay, if we purge Syria, we'll take all the refugees. That is punishment to us for the situation that we caused, you know, where the Jews fled Europe. So we'll take all of these refugees, and then that squares us up.
And then nobody will, when they hear German, think Nazi anymore.
Right, because we did something good. We took all these refugees in, and the Arabs and the Israelis.
And then just dumped them in Kosovo. Yeah, that wasn't an issue.
Yeah.
Right.
Ooh.
Right. Ooh. Boom. Yes.
Thanks, Hitler. That's the whole reason Serbia got. Well,
the Balkans in general have been on the receiving end of some bad stuff for the last, 400 years.
Yeah, you don't say Balkanization for nothing, you know?
Yeah. So I think the Germans feel a need to make right. And they can go to the Arabs and say, look, okay, we caused this problem and you guys have to live with the Jews now. Sorry about that. But hey, we took all the refugees from Syria. They came to Germany. We've integrated them into our society. Isn't the world a better place? Palestinians have a place to live. You have a place to live. The Israelis have a place to live. Hey, make nice with the Israelis now. That's my suspicion.
And when you said it to me 2+ years ago, I was like, oh my gosh, that makes sense. I'm not saying I believe it, but honestly, if I probably wouldn't put a lot of money on it, but if I was a betting man, which of course I'm not, because you know I'm a decent person.
I don't think it's going to actually settle anything. I don't think the states, the powers that have any interest in actually settling anything. They profit so much from the tumultuous.
Yeah, but they want to control the conflict. Tumultuousness. Maybe at this point,
right.
The Arabs
are
thinking,
it's just going to be shifting.
This is an issue that we're not controlling. Let's shift it to a different type of conflict that we have.
And this is why I have tremendous hope for Rojava.
Yes, and I want to find out more about Rojava. I've heard about it even before Bodhi and I. We do, I guess you could say, spontaneous shows with Tyagananda. Tyagananda, what's his last name?
Swaraj.
Tyagananda Swaraj, and he knows a lot about the Rojava group, and actually he's considering getting.
Wait, is that a made up name or is that a real person?
That's his Tyagananda is his chosen name. Swaraj is his given name.
Oh, okay.
From his
It's not like Brody or anything like that.
It's not like Bodhi the Brony. No. Bodhi the Brony is totally
that's my own doing.
That's his own doing. Bodhi the Brony is his own doing, and I have no responsibility in that whatsoever. None.
None.
Absolutely none.
No, I forgive you, Paul.
So, as a closing here, I'd like to invite both of you, and I will do the same. What is your prediction over what's going to happen over the next, say, 2 to 3 months?
It's going to be more of the same. There's going to be quote unquote isolated involvement, but it's going to be the same proxy wars. It's going to be a continuation of the proxy wars, and
perpetual war of some form.
Continual perpetual war, and yeah, I think Dimitri's idea of this shifting of the Palestinian problem. It's very likely that we'll shift to Syria, but they're going to run into tremendous problems. And I think Palestinians would take very well with the Peshmerga. And I think the states are going to have quite a thorn in their side.
So even a new Palestinian state in Syria would probably still want to go back to Gaza.
Yes.
You're not going to settle the issue with a Palestinian state in Syria.
Because they never wanted a state. They were never a state. They were a nation. They were a people.
Yeah, but after a couple of generations, that goes away.
I'm not sure about that. They've held on to some stuff for some generations.
Yeah, but
especially with the rise of the stateless society. State. I mean, it's coming. The statelessness of Rojava.
Yeah, but we're talking about the Palestinians.
I'm saying they would be great allies.
Okay. Now I don't necessarily know what's going to happen over the two to three months. I suspect that America is going to get increasingly more involved, and at some point, I don't know if it's going to happen within the next 2 to 3 months, but it's going to move in a direction where eventually you'll see some limited ground troops in America. But there's going to be a law of unintended consequences that is already happening. It's kind of happened in Iraq to a certain degree. And that is, and this is, on the surface, it's a bad thing. And it's bad in a lot of ways. But in a way, it's good. And that is the rise of private armies, the rise of the private military service. And yeah, it's doing some bad things now, and it's working for the state, but it's proving a model. And as they have to use it more and more, it's proving a model that you don't need a coercive enterprise to have a defensive force. Open market action. I won't say I'm excited about that, because I'm not really happy with the cost that is going to be paid for that example to be made, but
they're willing to pay it.
Yeah. So
you just need to listen to them, and they don't care. So they're nope.
What I'll be interested in is how is Trump going to pivot? Because I'm already seeing among the Trumpians, if you will, I almost say at this point right now, it's almost 50-50 what I'm seeing from the people that I know. Grave disappointment. And on the other hand, well, it's Trump. He knows what he's doing. But there's that 50% that are gravely, gravely disappointed that Trump is suddenly talking about a war in Syria. And yep. I'm wondering how Trump will pivot and make this. Well, I mean, he's going to, well, I got new intelligence information, and, you know, they didn't do this before. And well, what about 2013? Well, no, that wasn't them then, but this is them now. You know,
I think it's a prime opportunity for us to reach those people, actually.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yes. It's a prime opportunity for folks who reject coercive enterprises to reach the Trumpians.
People are being woke.
Yeah. And for me, one of the reasons that, I mean, this is Vis Priebus. My version is Vis Priebus. I don't know what Bodhi's going to call it. Oh, I want to point out that we are doing we're doing a simulcast. And so Bodhi's going to take his video, and he's going to do whatever he wants to do with his video. And I got my video, and I'll do whatever I want. You can also do whatever you want with these videos, because this is BIPCOT, no gov license. This is free to use any way that you can see fit. Just don't do it in a way where, yes, well, steal it, but don't pretend that you're me. That's the only thing that I'll ask you to do.
You can pretend you're me. You can pretend you're me. That's fine.
Yeah, not me. Don't pretend you're me. But what we're doing here, in a way, we're both like, I wanted to do this show for Viz Priebus. I got Bodhi on. Bodhi does live stream stuff all the time like I do. So, hey, if I have somebody on one of my shows that they do live stream stuff, hey, you want to do a simulcast and do your version? You know, I mean, that's like, that is showing folks who reject IP. It is showing it in real time, in real action, because I'm not claiming IP here, and neither is Bodhi. So, hey, two guys get on the same show. They're both doing this stuff. Two different shows, baby. Right now, two different shows.
Cutting edge.
One of the reasons that I wanted to actually talk about this on Viz Priebus, and Dimitri's the regular co-host on Viz Priebus, podcast for the individual, is I believe that there are opportunities here for folks like us, whether we're full out rejectors of the coercive enterprise or whether we have already recognized the absurdity of the coercive enterprise. There are opportunities coming here, sad opportunities, but opportunities. As you start to see what's going to happen in Syria, and you can talk to these people ahead of time and tell them what's going to happen, the bloodshed, the carnage, the pointlessness, you talk about it ahead of time, and as it starts to unfold, you're going to build standing with them. So you have opportunities to nudge them away from a blind adherence to an antiquated idea whose time should end. Course,
we're at it is the best of times to do such things.
Yes,
I would like to add something.
Go ahead, you can wrap up the show. Why don't you wrap up the show?
Rex Tillerson visited Turkey a couple of weeks ago, and prior administration had been very much against getting involved at least openly, we were very involved. The United States was very involved behind the scenes in Syria. But he went to Turkey recently, and I think he may have given them what they wanted, which is to remove Assad. And in exchange for not screwing with Israel, Cyprus, and Greece in their pipeline. I don't know what else he gave them, but I think it's very, very, very important to mention that Erdogan has a referendum to change the constitution of Turkey. And I believe the vote takes place next week. If he's successful with the yes vote, he will then become president of Turkey.
Both prime minister and president.
No, he will become president of Turkey, and Turkey then becomes structured more like the United States and less like a parliamentary system of Europe, which gives him complete
federalized.
Yes, and he becomes the executive branch essentially of Turkey. If he fails to secure the yes vote and he loses, he's going to be pissed and he's going to be looking for a scapegoat. And that scapegoat is probably going to be within the borders of Turkey and Syria. If he wins, he will be so emboldened that God only knows what that lunatic will set off to do. So if you want to know what's going to kick off in the next few weeks in the Middle East, watch Turkey. See what happens with this referendum. And see how the West is responding or not responding to the events that are unfolding. And that will tell you what we've got in store for the next couple of years, because things can get things are going to get even more interesting. He's blaming the coup on the Golanists, and he's purging anybody who utters a word that's anti him from all the institutions, including the military, the police, the schools. When you look at that, Turkey's A teams in the military are no longer in place its best and brightest are running for their lives and seeking asylum where? There are 230 Turks in Greece right now seeking asylum in Greece, their mortal enemy. Not to mention the rest of Europe. He has purged, like Stalin did, his best and brightest out of the military. And if you want to see something kick off accidentally, this will be the time. These are very perilous times for that part of the world. And the shifts in the geopolitical organization there are going to be with us for the next 200 years.
Bodhi, do you have any closing remarks there?
Just in regards to Turkey, there's still a very strong underground. I'll just leave it at that.
Yeah. And my closing remarks are, in case you haven't noticed, folks, here comes the new boss, same as the old boss. Whatever Donald Trump started out with in just a few short months, I think it's pretty clear that Donald Trump is more and more conforming to the wishes of those who are the real power, the owners and managers of the coercive enterprise that you call the United States of America. And on that note, a cheerful note, which it gives us plenty of opportunity to show people how absurd all of this is. On that note, we'll see you. We won't see you next week because I am doing Passion Week. I'm not doing any shows next week. By the way, Dimitri, there you go. You know, not doing any shows next week. I'll probably do some spontaneous live streams with that are related to the Passion Week. But so we'll see you 2 weeks from now with Dimitri. And I don't know what Dimitri and I are going to talk about. And I don't know if we'll have another person on or not. But Bodhi, Mr. Andrew Marich, thank you so much for being on Viz Previs. It was great having you on. And I was really happy to have both of you on together. And yeah, it was pretty cool. I enjoyed this. So.
Bodhi, it was Bodhi. Nice meeting you.
Yes, it was nice to meet you. And if you're bored next week, we can always do a show too. Screw Paul.
Hey, he's know
bored.
What? Yeah, you I can. Like that idea.
Yeah. Actually, yeah. Dimitri's on Facebook. I'll make sure that you guys friend each other.
Yeah.
All right. Good. 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 Peace. Show. Good times. Goodbye.
Peace out. Peace out.